a brand new one I'm gonna share with you tonight. Are you ready? Goes like this. You make the blind man.
Describe the feeling I have down inside.
It's hard to
contain.
So I'll simply say,
Jesus, I love you.
I love you.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Woo! Let's say that one more time. Come on, everybody, lift your voices. Millions of words can
describe
the feeling that I have.
I have down inside.
It's so hard to contain.
It's hard to
contain.
So I'll simply say,
everybody say,
Jesus,
I love you.
I love you.
Woo! Because you first loved me.
I'm
returning my love back to you.
There's
no one.
Welcome to another Wednesday in the Word. I pray that you and your family are safe and well, and you are experiencing the blessings, the joy, the peace, the grace of God our Father. It is certainly in Him that we live, we move, and we have our very being. I'm so excited to come into your homes, into your offices, wherever you may be tonight, to declare the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm so excited for us to get an opportunity to pick up where we left off. We have been in this book of St. Matthew, and we have been journeying all the way up to this time in chapter 26. I hope you have been being blessed by the word each and every week. I certainly have. It has challenged me, and it has changed me, and some convictions have taken place, but it's also caused me to grow. And I know that that's one of the great things about God. God wants you and I to grow in the grace, here it is, and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That's our responsibility. We are to study, to show ourselves approved unto God. And when we're studying, when we're searching the scriptures, I believe the Holy Spirit infuses us and causes us to grow and have these aha moments where He gives us revelation. He gives us information. And then listen, we are to put it into application. Can you say amen to that? So listen, I want you to get your Bibles, get your notepads, your smart devices, get your notepads, whatever it is you do. And I want you to meet me in the book of St. Matthew, chapter number 26. While you're doing that, I want to breathe a word of prayer, and I want to ask God's blessings on our time. Will you pray with me? Father, we come to you thanking you for this another day you have allowed us to see, Lord. We thank you for your protections, your mercies. Thank you, Father, for all that you have done for us. We thank you for being such a wonderful God, dear Lord, that we just exalt and praise your holy and righteous name. Now, Lord, as we come into your presence, we acknowledge our own sins and our own transgressions, and we pray and ask that you would please forgive us for every one of them in thought, in word, and in deed. Father, today I pray that you will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Help us to be more like you. Now, Father, I pray for my brothers and sisters. You know their need. You know, God, their concerns. Father, many of them have questions. I pray tonight that you will speak to them. God, let your word go forth, God, freely and with power. Now, bless us, God, once again, as we take time to go through your word. And we give you thanks and praise for what is to come, for healing, for salvation, for deliverance, for direction, for peace. Whatever my brother or sister needs tonight, I thank you that they will receive it through the word of God. Now we bless you for what is to come in Jesus Christ our Lord. Thank God and amen. All right, Matthew chapter 26. Now, for those of you who may have not been with us over the last several weeks, just to kind of do a little backdrop, if you will, not much of a backdrop because we have a lot to cover tonight. We understand that we are, as Jesus, if you will, in the season of Lent or Lenten. We're in this season of Lenten, and in the season of Lent, we understand that Lent is a season that brings about pain, isolation, brokenness. It brings about hurt. And listen, Lent can even bring about death. So in this painful season where there's isolation and hurt and pain and brokenness, all of these things in Lent, we may have experienced it for ourselves, but as we have been journeying through Matthew chapter 26, we see that Jesus experienced some of these times where Lent may have taken place in his life. Why do you say that, Pastor Chris? I'm glad you asked that. Well, you do remember where Jesus in this chapter, where he was betrayed by one of his very own, Judas Iscariot, betrayed Jesus. And I don't know about you, but if I've been betrayed, and betrayal brings about brokenness, it brings about hurt. Listen, betrayal can bring about isolation. All of those are characteristics that we find in the season of Lent. We talked a little bit last week about how Jesus was also, not only was he betrayed, but in this same chapter, we see that he was denied. Have you ever been denied where somebody did not claim you, did not, didn't want to say that you or they were together? You know, I know y'all haven't had that, but you know, the embarrassment, if you will, of being with somebody. Jesus was denied. And guess what? He was denied by his own. The Bible talks about Peter, but listen, he also was denied by the other disciples. Y'all remember we talked a little bit about that. They denied Jesus. And I don't know about you, but denial can bring about some of those same characteristics of Lent. Tonight, I want to kind of talk about what do we do? What can we do in Lent? And in Lent, sometimes, although we do the right thing, which we'll talk about, sometimes this right thing can be agonizing because we know that we gotta go through it anyway. Tonight, I want to talk to you about prayer. Oh, prayer. Can I tell you, prayer is something that every believer needs, but every believer doesn't always do. I know you don't want, you're not going to say amen to that, but truth be told, when you look at the numbers, when we were able to gather, when we were able to come together, you can have, revivals. People will come to revivals. People will come to musicals. People will come to church. But you'll have some folk come to Bible study. But when it's prayer meeting time, where everybody needs prayer, everybody wants folk to pray for them, but many times during that time of prayer, everybody doesn't come out. That's a whole nother Bible study. We'll get to that. But tonight I want to talk to you, and I want us to look at what Jesus did. Jesus went through a time in this season of prayer. And in this prayer, I want to challenge somebody tonight, because I'm going to mess with somebody's old way of thinking. All right, y'all with me? Let's jump down to verse number 36. Chapter 26, let's jump down to verse number 36. Let me set the table by saying this. Tonight, here is the subject. If I were to take a subject to preach from or teach from, tonight I'll talk to you from the subject of pray again. Pray again. You can type that in. Pray again. All right, here we go. Let's jump down to verse number 36. Here goes a reading of God's word from the New King James translation of the Bible. Then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and called to the disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray over there." And he took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Then he said to them, "My soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me." Verse 39, he went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Then he came to his disciples and found them sleeping and said to Peter, "What? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, a second time, he went away and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done." And he came and found them asleep again, for their eyes were heavy. So he left them, went away again, and prayed the third time, saying the same words.
Then he came to his disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Behold, the hour is at hand, and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hand of sinners. Rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand." Can you say amen? Remember, once again, tonight I want to really encourage somebody from the subject matter of pray again. Now let's go back, let's go back and let's kind of unpack this text a little bit. Let's see how we navigate through this pericope. And listen, on your paper, on your notes, I want you to begin to respond personally, yourself, to what is God saying to you. Remember, there are three things for those who have joined us and don't know our philosophy when it comes to our time of teaching, but it is simply this. What does the word say? What does the word mean? And then, what does the word mean to me? What is God saying to me about this that I'm reading? Are you there? Good. Here we go. Verse 36. Here we go. Jesus said, the Bible says, then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, "Sit here while I go and pray over there." Stop right there. Now, Jesus comes to this place called Gethsemane. Gethsemane is a garden, and in this garden, it is located at the foot of the Mount of Olives. The name is formed, and it is Gath, or Gath meaning a press, and Shemen meaning oil. So he comes to this place called Gath Shemen. It is the place of the pressing of the oil. It's a garden. This garden called Gethsemane is where the oil from the olives were pressed and squeezed. Now, I don't have time, but I can talk to you about those that are anointed. You know that when you are anointed, it is a squeeze. It is something that God, you have to go through something to get the anointing, the oil, if you will, that rests on your life. That's a whole nother something, but for somebody, that's your shouting cue. Here it is. Jesus came to this place called Gethsemane. Now this place was a place that Jesus frequently visited with his disciples. The Bible says in John chapter 18, verses 1 and 2, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples over the brook Kidron, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. And Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. Can you say amen? So here it is. Jesus and his disciples come to a place that they are familiar with. This place is a special place. It's a place that... you know, we'll come to it in a little bit, where Judas knew where Jesus would be because Jesus frequented that location with his disciples. So here it is now. The Bible says when they came, Jesus tells the majority of the disciples to sit here, all right? Which lets us know, this is point number one for some people, which lets you know everybody can't go everywhere with you, even in spiritual things. Did you get that? Let that marinate. Let me give it to you one more time. Everybody, just because they go to, you know, profess Jesus as their Lord, and listen, just because somebody goes to the same church, everybody can't go everywhere with you when it comes to your personal life. They can't go with you everywhere when it comes to your spiritual life. Jesus told the majority of disciples, "Sit here while I go over there." He tells them to sit here, to stay in this place while I go over yonder. One translation says, "Go over yonder to pray." Now, it wasn't stated, but it seems to me to be implied that these disciples were simply to just sit here and wait. But while they were waiting, I would think that there was some maybe minor expectation, or maybe it was implied that they were not to just sit and do nothing, but because they knew something about what was happening, they had just been with Jesus and the plot to kill Jesus had taken place. They understood because the anointing had taken place in Bethany by Mary. They understood, you know, they had already had the Passover and Jesus had broken bread. So it would be implied that they must know something is going on here. We probably need to spend some time in prayer because Jesus is going over there to pray, but he tells us to sit here. Now, I want to encourage somebody just right at this place because whenever you seem to be in a place where you're waiting on Jesus, it's like I'm waiting on the Lord. You know, Pastor, I'm just sitting here waiting. I don't know what he's going to do. I don't know when he's going to move. May I encourage you while you're waiting to spend time in prayer? While you're waiting on the Lord, you prayed or, you know, maybe you're waiting on God to make a move or something, whatever it is. Maybe you can just spend time in prayer. Just that time of worship, that time of thanking him, whatever it is. You know, many times, if I may say it, thank you, Lord, many times some of us should take time to thank God for what he's done before we keep asking for him to do something else. All right. I know that went over somebody's head, so let me bring it down again. Many times, some of us are waiting on God to do the next thing, to bring the next blessing, to answer our next prayer. But many times, we should simply take time to thank him for what he's already done. And listen, what he is yet doing right now. I think that'll help somebody. So anyway, Jesus tells his disciples, sit here and pray. Let me roll a little faster. Verse 37, here's what he says. Watch what he does. He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, and he began to be sorrowful and deeply distressed. Verse 38. And he said to them, my soul is exceedingly sorrowful, even to death. Stay here and watch with me. Can you say amen? Watch now. Look at the picture. Jesus leaves 9 of them back there, and he takes three. He takes Peter and the sons of Zebedee, James and John. He takes Peter, James, and John. He leaves those nine, and he takes these disciples, and he begins to share with them things that are going on in his life. Peter, James, and John, those of you who've been studying the Bible, you know that Peter and the sons of Zebedee, these guys, they were more of Jesus's intricate circle of disciples. Maybe you remember back in Matthew chapter 17. Matthew 17, these were the guys that got a chance to be with Jesus as he was transfigured on the mountain. Those of you maybe you know the story over in Mark chapter 5, when Jesus raised the little girl back to life in Mark chapter 5, he had put everybody out, but he took with him Peter, James, and John so that they might be able to go in with Jesus. Here it is. We see once again Jesus in these intimate moments, in things where he might be able to show his divinity. He doesn't bring all of the disciples, but he brings this small nucleus, this core group, thank you, Lord, this core group of disciples, he shows himself to them. He's more expressive. He begins to be more personal with them. Watch, this is going to help some folk. He had left nine, he brings these three, and he shares with them what's going on with him. All right, put a pin in that. This is the next cue for somebody. You can't tell everybody everything, but I believe God does put certain people in our lives that we're able to share some of the intimate details, some of the personal things that we're going through. Times, listen, of heaviness, times of sorrow, times of disappointment, times of heartbreak. Times that we can't tell everybody, but There might be one or two folk that God has brought into your inner circle, your core group, that you can share with. So this helps about 50 of y'all. Don't post everything and every feeling on your social media outlet. Don't go to Facebook and just tell all your business. Stay off Instagram. Stop texting everybody. And if God has blessed you with about two or three folk that you can share with, Jesus gives the example. He shared with Peter and James and John. He shared with them. And as he shared with them, I believe, like many of us, when we share with folk, we should share with people, because I know I need to help somebody. We should share with people that we know will have our back, that will not go out and blab our business, people that will cover us. Listen, and most importantly, people that will lift you in prayer to God. People that will lift you in prayer. Jesus shared how he was feeling. He was feeling sorrowful. He was feeling anguish. He was feeling heavy. The Bible says even to death. And he shared that with Peter and James and John. Are you still with me? Watch now. He was feeling this sorrow. He was feeling this heaviness because he knew within hours he would have to drink from the divine cup of fury. He was going to drink from that divine cup of fury against mankind or humankind's sin. Let me look at what the Bible says. Verse number 39. Are y'all there? Here's what it says. He went a little farther. After he left Peter and James and John, he shared with them and he left them. So here it is. He left the nine. He takes the three a little further. And let me say this, because it just can't. Thank you, Lord. Don't get jealous when the Lord brings or uses somebody else and he leaves you in certain places, because everybody can't handle everything. The Bible puts it this way: to whom much is given, much is required. And whatever group you fall in, whether it's in a personal relationship or with different ones within ministry or church, just thank God that you're in the number somewhere, okay? So here it is, Jesus leaves them, and then watch, here's the third thing that you gotta get, because it's gonna help somebody. Then Jesus leaves Peter, James, and John, and then he goes on by himself. Here's the third point. At some point, you're gonna have to just be alone with God for yourself. You can take certain people to certain places, but at some point, it's going to just be you and God. Look at what verse 39 says. He went a little farther and fell on his face and prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Can you say amen? So watch. He leaves Peter, James, and John, and he goes a little farther. And the Bible says he falls on his face. He fell on his face, which is an implication of going and being prostrate before God. He's laying prostrate and he's lying with his face down, which means it is a picture of total submission, total trust, complete humility, humbling himself all the way down, and he's praying with his face to the ground, but he's praying to his Father. Notice the words that he says in his prayer. He says, "Oh, my Father, if it is possible," here it is, "let this cup pass from me." Stop right there. Pastor Eric, a few weeks ago, he touched a little bit on talking about a cup, one of the cups that is mentioned in Scripture. But if you look, there are several cups from a theological standpoint that many think that, you know, Jesus or the cups that we may have to drink from. Of course, you know, there's a cup of salvation. There's a cup of deliverance. There's a cup of redemption. There's a cup of praise. And Pastor Eric dealt with that, speaking on the cup of communion. So we're not talking about all of those cups, but tonight when we look at the cup that Jesus is speaking of, he is speaking of the cup that deals with God's divine wrath. this cup because of mankind. No, that's the wrong word. Humankind, sin. Because of sin, he was going to drink from this cup. Let me give you some scripture to help out. Isaiah chapter 51, verse 17. Look at what the word says. Awake, awake, stand up, O Jerusalem, you who have drunk at the hand of the Lord of the cup of his fury. You have drunk the dregs of the cup of trembling and drained it out. Chapter 51, verse 22. Jump down there, verse 21 of Isaiah. Chapter 51, verse 22. Here's what it says. Thus says your Lord, the Lord your God, who pleads the cause of his people. See, I have taken out of your hand the cup of trembling, the dregs of the cup of my fury. You shall no longer drink it. Can you say amen? So here it is. Jesus now is preparing to drink from this cup of the fury, the wrath of God. And he's doing that because he's about to take on the sins of the world. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21, for he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Can you say amen? Listen, that's a shouting scripture right there. He took on, he who knew no sin, he became sin for us. Listen, so that you and I might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Jesus was feeling the weight. He was feeling the pressure and the strain of carrying the sins of the world to go to the cross. He was in this season of Lent. Bible says he prayed. And in his prayer, he says, Father, if it would let this cup, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me. God, if it be your will, and there's another way around it, let's go that route. But then he uses this word. He says, nevertheless. I love that word. He says, Father, if there's another way to do it, let's do it. In other words, he says, but if we can't go another way, nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. That is for somebody. You need to highlight that, underline it, circle it. Listen, we have to get to a place, in all areas of our life where, listen, we pray and we ask God, and Lord, if it's your will, you know, for us, if it can go a different way, if we can go another way to do this, that, and the other, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. We have to get to that place, and I'm trying not to shout right now, but when we look at this, and Jesus making this in his prayer to the Father, this statement shows how he was completely submitted to the will of God. He was completely submitted to him. Although they were one, he understood that he prayed to his Father for his Father's will to be done. This shows us how in his humanity, he voluntarily surrendered to the will of God. Jesus voluntarily surrendered and submitted to God's will. He says, nevertheless. In other words, he says, if you decide to take this cup from me, cool. But not my will, but your will be done. Are you still there? Let's keep rolling. We almost where we need to be. The Bible says in verse number 40, after he finished that prayer, which, listen, this is for somebody. Prayer does not have to be long, but it has to be effective. Did you get that? You don't have to, you know, have a long, drawn out prayer, but the words that you speak, that the Holy Spirit prompts in your heart and in your spirit to pray, it should be effective. Jesus said these few words, and the Bible says, then he came in verse 40 to the disciples and found them, Peter, James, and John, sleeping. And said to Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Stop right there. You know, Pete was, you know, Pete's his dude. Pete's the one that was just talking all of that talk. Father, you know, Jesus, I'll die with you. I'll never deny you. I mean, he had done all of that talking, and here it is now. Jesus says, listen, I'm feeling sorrowful. I'm feeling heavy. I need y'all to watch with me for a while. He comes back, and these boys are doing what some of y'all do after y'all eat. You know who I'm talking about. Some of y'all just get to snoring and drooling and everything after you have eaten. And it seems like the disciples, after they had had, you know, that Passover meal and Jesus had broken bread, these fellas, they just did what some of y'all are doing now. They're getting lazy and comfortable. But listen, that's not the time for us to sleep. When Jesus wants us to be watchful, but he shows us something, that these disciples, listen, they're like many of us. They just got sleepy. They were full. They had the itis. Y'all know what the itis is. They had the itis, and they went to sleep. Y'all, just pray for me. Just pray for me. Just pray for me. So these disciples watch. He says, what, could you not watch with me 1 hour? Okay, if the truth be told, some of us, if we were to look at our friends and the people that we call ourselves, you know, close to, after we've shared certain things with them, we may think that they would be praying for us or doing some things, but truth be told, you know, some of them are asleep on the job. They're not really doing that. They're just asleep on the job. That's the truth of the matter, I would think. Watch what happens. Verse 41, Jesus then tells them, here's what I need you to do, guys. In essence, he says, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. Then he says, the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Can you say amen? So watch, Jesus now specifically tells them, he had already told them in verse number 39 that he wanted them to watch with him. In verse number 38, I believe it was, he brings Peter, James, and John, and he tells them to watch with him. Spirit was heavy, and he tells them to watch with him. But here it is now, he's more specific in this time in verse 41. He says, listen, I need you to watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. He understood something, though, because we love the fact that in all points in our humanity, Jesus understood and he understands. Because he says something in that next part of that same, that B clause of that verse. He says, the spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Jesus was acquainted with their human feelings of tiredness, and he understood their infirmities. The Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 15, for we do not have a high priest who can sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Can you say amen? Jesus understands what you feel and what you go through. There is not a point and place in your life, ma'am, a point and place in your life, sir, that he does not understand. And listen, not only does he understand what you're going through, but he knows how to bring you through it. Woo, that's some good news. So Jesus understood. He understood what was going on with his disciples. Watch this now. Let me get to where I got to go to. Y'all be nice over there. Y'all be nice. Come on. Verse 42. Here's what he says. Again. A second time, he went away and prayed, saying, oh, my Father, if this cup cannot pass away from me unless I drink it, your will be done. Verse 43, and he came and found them asleep again. Lord, have mercy, for their eyes were heavy. Stop right there for a moment. Check this out. Isn't this interesting? Jesus went and he prayed again. And after he prayed again, he went back to his disciples. It doesn't even say it was an hour. He went back and found his disciples. They were asleep again. Can I tell you something? Some of us, listen, if we were like Jesus, we probably would be, you know, not y'all now, but, you know, some folk way back then, you might have had some words for your friends. You can't watch with me. I'm telling you, I'm going through. Y'all, you know. But some folk, you know, you're feeling that because you're like, hey, I'm in need. I'm going through something heavy, something burdensome, something challenging. And I'm talking to the Father and I need my friends to kind of have my back. And these guys are over there sleep again. Watch what verse 44 says. And I'm getting ready to land this plane. So he left them and went away and prayed the third time. Here it is. Saying the same words. Stop right there, child of God. Here is where I want to mess with somebody's theology. Some of you may have been like me growing up, where we have heard that you're supposed to only pray one time about something. When you pray to God, listen, God is all-knowing. He's omniscient. You don't have to keep reminding God about something. You pray to him one time in Jesus' name and you leave it alone. Well, ma'am, sir, I see something in Scripture that lets me know that not only can I pray to God about the same thing more than once, listen, but sometimes I can pray saying the same words. Some folk probably have been burdened and you know you want to go to God again. Lord, I need you to do such and such. Father, is this such and such? Whatever that may be, but we've heard, we've had it rehearsed in our mind that we can't say and pray to God more than one time about it. But child of God, here is the word of the Lord for you tonight. Pray again. I don't know who I'm talking to, but I know I'm talking to you. Pray again. Listen, God is waiting. He already knows. He's omniscient. He's all knowing. He has all of that. He understands. But can I tell you something? The prayer is not for him, but the prayer is for you. And that prayer, after you pray again, child of God, listen here. You are praying, but I want you to get to a place just like Jesus, that at the end of your prayer, you get to a place where you say, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. Child of God, listen here. When we get to that place, we are exemplifying our faith and our trust in God. We are saying to God, listen, we trust you. Lord, you know what our desire is. You know what our request is. But Lord, not my will, not our will, but your will be done. Because we know when his will is being done, man, listen, there is nothing, any demon, any devil, there's nothing that can stop the will of God for your life. Many of us are blessed because we've been walking in the will of God. And many of us have already prayed the nevertheless prayer. Lord, not my will, but your will be done. That's the word I want to share with you tonight. Even in this season of Lent, as you may be going through difficult times, I want to encourage you to pray again. You might be having difficult times financially. Pray again. You know what you need to do. Budget, tithe, amen. Give your offering. Do those things, but pray again. You may be having difficulty in your family, in your marriage, in your career, with school, whatever it may be, even in health. Pray again. And we are going to get to a place at Second Baptist Church where we are already doing. We're at a place where we trust God completely. Nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. That's what Jesus did. The Bible says something that he did after that. He comes back and then he tells his disciples in verse 45, he came to them, to his disciples and said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Behold, the hour is at hand and the Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of sinners. And he tells them something, rise, let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. That's that pericope on tonight. Child of God, the word of the Lord for you tonight is simply pray again. I don't know why. That's just the urgency. I sense the urgency to encourage you to pray again. And you're ending that prayer with not my will, but your will be done, Father. Amen. In this season of Lent, we're going to pray again. We are already a praying church, but we are really going to be a praying church. Amen. And we're going to see, I believe, some more miracles, some more signs and wonders of God hearing and answering our prayers. Listen, because we are submitted to his will. I believe, ma'am, I believe, sir, after you pray again, even if you've got to pray the same words, Listen, and these words, thank you, Father, are not just words of repetition, but these are words of sincerity that are coming from the heart that, listen here, are led and breathed on by the Holy Spirit who's prompting you to say what you pray.
Amen.
So tonight, if you're here, you've heard this word, and you say, listen, Pastor, I know I got to get it right with the Lord. Because can I tell you, some of you are part of the nevertheless prayer where many times some of our parents and grandparents and aunties and uncles have been praying for many folk. We've been praying. You've been lifted before the Lord. Tonight is your night. Text that number. It says prayer. If you've never given your life to Christ Jesus, I want you to know he loves you. He died for your sins. He was going to drink that cup of fury, listen, for my sins, but also for yours. If you want to give them a chance to come into your life, text that number. There's going to be some men and women of God to pray for you. Somebody else, you say, I need prayer because maybe you feel like the group of nine disciples that were left. Well, actually, you know what? It was eight disciples because Judas had already gone and he was doing what he did. Eight disciples. And then maybe you're in that group and you're praying. Maybe you're part of that inner core group. And Jesus is leaving you somewhere. And maybe you've been able to walk with some friends into certain places and now they've got to go on their own. Maybe you're in that group and you need to be praying for them. Whatever it is, if you need somebody to pray with you, text that number. I'm going to pray. All right? Let's bow. Father, we thank you and praise you for this day, for this time. We thank you for your word. Your word will not return unto you void, but going to accomplish everything that you set forth for your word to accomplish in our lives. I thank you for this example through scripture, Father, how we see our Savior coming to you again and praying again. Father, I bless you for this. I pray, God, today that you will free and encourage my brother and sister and let them know that they can come to you again in prayer, Father. And even if their petition is the same, thank you that you are a God who hears and answers our prayers. So I just bless you for them. I pray that you will encourage their hearts, God. I pray that you will strengthen their areas of weakness tonight in the name of Jesus. I thank you that you are a healing God. So, Father, whatever's going on physically in bodies tonight, I pray in Jesus' name that you will let your healing virtue flow. Father, you know the very numbers of hair on our head. You know every tissue, every cell in our bodies. So Father, in Jesus' name, we pray, God, that you will touch and heal. God, whether it's cancer, whether it's diabetes, whether it's arthritis, whether it's COVID-19, whatever, heart, lungs, kidneys, whatever's going on, thank you, Father, for your word. You were wounded for our transgressions. You were bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of peace was upon you, but with your stripes, glory to God, we were healed. So we pray the manifestation of healing take place in our physical bodies. Thank you for it. I pray, God, that you will encourage us, touch us, comfort those that have lost loved ones, continue to be with them. God, let them know that you're ever present. Father, those that need direction, I thank you, Lord. You said in your word, if we acknowledge you in all of our ways, you will direct our path. So I thank you for directing them as they acknowledge, as they pray to you, Father. And Father, our prayer is going to be ended with nevertheless, not our will, but your will be done. We trust you, we love you, and we bless you. And we do this in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Thank God and amen. Somebody just put that in the chat. Pray again. Pray again. Amen. Listen, thank you so very much for tuning in on tonight. Our announcing clerk is going to come and share some very important announcements in just a moment. I want to first take this moment and give just a couple quick things. I want to thank you for those of you who continue to pay your tithe and give your offerings. Thank you so much. As you're continuing to obey God, you're continuing to bless this body of believers to continue to serve our community and be a blessing to our membership. Thank you so very much. Listen, on this coming Friday, y'all don't tell, it's our bishop's birthday. It's our bishop. Listen, it is Bishop's birthday. And listen, this young man will be 85 years young. I want us to continue to pray for our bishop. Wish him a happy birthday anniversary. We love he and his wonderful family, and we continue to lift them before the Lord daily, and we just trust God to continue to do great things with him. So happy birthday, Bishop. Happy birthday anniversary to you from myself and your wonderful Second Baptist Church family. So we remember that. Listen, on this coming Sunday, I need you to invite a family friend to tune in. It is our ushers' day, our greeters and hospitality, those wonderful men and women of God who stand at the door greeting. We acknowledge and praise God for them. Although we have not been able to come into the sanctuary, into the edifice over this last year, we certainly thank God for their willingness to serve. Many of them, you know what, listen, they may be marching around their house practicing to make sure they still got their march. I mean, I'm telling you, you never know. Mother Mary Price and Mother Mary Bourne, hey, get out there, and Sister Laura and Miss Michelle, and you know, all these ushers, they giving you signs and telling you what to do, and I mean, you know, all of that. They still practicing because they're excited about coming back to the house of the Lord. So I want you to tune in on this coming Sunday as we praise God for our ushers and greeters and our hospitality members. All right, so that's my time. Our announcing clerk is going to lead us in our time of giving and give you a few announcements. In the meantime, know that I love you with the love of the Lord, and there ain't one thing you could do about it. And if the Lord should tarry his coming and the creek don't rise, I look forward to seeing you this coming Sunday morning at 10:45, where it will be fresh and live. We will be lifting up the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Love you. Stay safe, stay well, stay home, and we'll see you then. God bless you. Bye-bye.
Set for Life has been invited to partner with Kaiser Permanente for the distribution of vaccines. Most importantly, you don't even have to be a Kaiser member to participate. Appointments are on a first-come, first-served basis. If you have questions about taking the vaccine, the COVID-19 vaccine, please consult your physician. The details are, and the eligibility are, you must be 65 years old and over. You can reside in Los Angeles, San Bernardino, Riverside, or Orange County. The location to receive your vaccine is Cal Poly Pomona. Current vaccine dates are March 12th through March 18th. You will be booked for the first available appointment date. No special date requests are available. It will be on weekdays from 8 a.m. to 8 p.m. and on the weekends from 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. If you meet the above qualifications, you can be scheduled to get your COVID-19 vaccine. You can contact the church at 626-358-2136, or you can send them an email at sbcmon925@gmail.com.
Hey there, community college students. Ascending Lights is looking for talented young adults who are facing educational and economical obstacles, but still want to serve the church and the community by reducing violence and poverty. If you are interested, they would love for you to apply for their scholarship at www.ascendinglights.org or contact Dan at 323-356-0689.
This Sunday is annual Usher and Welcome and Hospitality Day. So pull out those white gloves and your pearly white smiles, and we'll see you at 10:45.
Need your help to spread the word. Teen Summit 2021, Saturday, June 26, 2021. RSVP if you want to be a part of the summit, which will be hosted virtually and with limited seating capacity.
Black Life Matters. And every Thursday at 7 p.m., Dr. Harris and the Boosters take our teens to another level. Check your post as well as your text messages and emails for the Zoom information. Your teen doesn't want to miss it.
God's Word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. So join us at 7 p.m. for Wednesday in the Word.
Second Baptist Church Children's Ministry welcomes all children to join its Zoom church service every Sunday at 10 a.m. Please call the church office for Zoom link to join the service.
Teens in Progress is back, and we want every teen you have to experience the love of God. Teens learn and understand God's word with their peers. Every Sunday at 9:45, see the posting for more details.
You can bless Second Baptist and the community from where you are right now. You can go to our website, sbcmonrovia.org/give, or you can send your check to P.O. Box 479, Monrovia, California, 91017, or you can give on the app, the Give Plus app, and search our whole name, Second Baptist Church of Monrovia. When you bless us, God will surely bless you.
And those are your announcements for this week.